Well, good morning, everybody. Welcome to Parkway. For those of you that call Parkway your church home, we're glad you're here this morning. For those of you that are visiting with us today, we're really glad you're here this morning. And last week I had everybody say hi to the person next to them. That seemed to work pretty good because it mostly quieted you down a little bit. So I'm going to ask you to do the same thing. Say hi to the guy next to you. On both sides. And say, welcome to Parkway. Okay. Let's not get carried away. Isn't it great to be in God's house today? Amen. Expecting great things? You're not answering me. Are you expecting great things this morning? Amen. Whenever we come together, Jesus says, whenever two or three gather in my name, I am in the midst of them. And we just expect that the Lord's going to be with us this morning. So we're going to ask God to touch those that need to be touched today, to be our encourager today, that we will come in for encouragement. So I'm going to ask the worship team to come and the prayer team to come. And if you need prayer this morning, those folks on the prayer team will pray with you and for you. And we just believe that God's going to do wonderful and mighty things. Amen? God's going to do wonderful and mighty things. Gail thinks so. Does anybody else? Amen. Let's stand. Well, Heavenly Father, we thank you this morning for your love and care for us. That God, we can with freedom come into this place to worship you, and we thank you for that. We thank you for living in a place where we can have freedom to worship and to praise you. So, Lord, we give you praise and thanks for that this morning. And we also ask, God, that as we come to you with needs, that you will be more than sufficient to meet every need that we lay before you this morning. As we come to this altar, we ask, God, that you will just bless those that have requests today, whether it's for provision or whether it's for relationships, whatever it might be, Father, you are the answer. So we come to you today and we say thank you in advance that you are with us, that, Father, you want to meet our needs this morning, and that, Father God, you just love us through whatever we're walking through today, and that you will be encouragement for us this morning. In Jesus' name we pray. Everybody say it. Amen. Amen.
Hosanna, Hosanna, Stories of what they think you're like, but I've heard the tender whisper of love in the dead of night, and you tell me that you're pleased and that I'm never alone. You're a good, good father to This next song is might be a little new to most of you. But it's a beautiful song, and it's a song that is really written as a prayer. And, you know, we come to church, and we come to sing, and we come to hear. We come to fellowship. But the most important thing we can do is hear the truth that God is speaking to us. And to do that, we have to give something up. We have to let go of ourselves, let go of the things that are standing between us and God. Get rid of the junk that we brought in from the week and the world. You know, Jesus washed Peter's feet. Peter had been walking out in the world all week, and he said, you need to have your feet cleaned. We need to listen to what God has to say to us. So I hope you take this song. It's very simple. It's an opportunity not just to sing but to pray. Here's my heart, Lord. Here's my heart, Lord. Here's my heart, Lord. Speak what is true. Here's my
than here.
speak what is true. I just want to take a few minutes, a few seconds here. Just keep praying. Keep offering your heart to Him. I'm just going to be silent for a minute, just a little music, but it's you and God right now. Here's my heart, Lord. Oh, here's my heart, Lord. Here's my heart, Lord. Speak what is true. Speak what is true.
Our Father everlasting, the all-creating God Almighty, through your Holy Spirit conceiving Christ the Son, Jesus our Savior. I believe in God our Father. I believe in Christ the Son. I believe in the Holy Spirit. Our God is three in one. I believe in the resurrection, that we will rise again. And our defender suffered and crucified. Forgiveness is in you. Descended into darkness, you rose in glorious light. Forever seated high. I believe in God our Father. I believe in Christ the Son. Saints communion and in your holy church. I believe in the resurrection when Jesus comes again. For I believe in the name of Jesus. I believe in God our Father. I believe in Christ the Son. I believe in the Holy Spirit. Our God is three in one. I believe.
I believe in the sun. I believe in the risen one. And I believe I overcome by the power of his blood. Amen. Amen. I'm alive. I'm alive because he lives. Amen. Amen. Let my song join the one that never ends, because he lives. I was dead in the grave. Oh, I was covered in sin and shame. I heard mercy call my name. Oh, he rode the storm away. Amen.
So in our worship time earlier, we sang this song that describes God. It says, he's a good father. That's who he is. And then it describes our response to that we are loved. That's who we are. And I just can't stress enough how important it is for you to capture the reality of the fact that you are loved by God. How just amazing that is, and how it changes everything. And I don't mean just in that cheap sense that says, oh, God loves me, I can just do whatever I want. I mean, that's just so silly. I mean, that's 2-year-old. Let's grow up. But that sense that, wait a minute, I don't have to be afraid. I don't have to be anxious. I don't have to be overwhelmed. I'm loved by God. There's a security here that holds me for eternity. And it also motivates me toward better behavior, not my excuse for worse behavior. It's the thing that calls me to my best, the best that I could be, to be the person that God created me to be and to accomplish the thing that he designed for me to accomplish. It is just so life-changing to know that you are loved by God. What an amazing thing. I don't think you can sing that song enough. He's a good father. That's who he is. And I am loved by him. That's who I am. And it says that all of his ways are perfect. And there will be some days when you're going to have to just take that by faith, because they are not going to be preferred. There's a difference between preferred and perfect. All of His ways are perfect. They are not always preferred, because it's the tough stuff that makes you strong. And some of us would much rather be weak. Let me be a wimp for Jesus. You know, I mean, we don't want to go through this stuff that makes us strong. And Jesus just looks at us and says, that's not your best. I didn't call you to be a wimp. That's not your best. So let's go work out. I don't want to work out. I know, but you'll never be your best if you don't. It's just such an amazing thing to know you're loved by God. And I want you to just say thanks for that. But I want us to also just pray for our friends and our community. There are so many people that do not know that He is a good and loving Heavenly Father. They don't get that. They don't know that. And they're desperately trying to fill that in with something else. And it's just not going to work. Just not going to work. So, Father, we just want to say thank You. You are a good, good Father. You designed us, You made us, You created us, You've given us destiny, You've given us purpose, You've given us opportunity. I thank You for that. And You redeemed us on top of all of that when we had messed it all up. And we say thank You. Thank You for being a good Heavenly Father. And thank You for loving us. Not loving us when we got it together, but loving us while we were all messed up. Thank You for that. Thank You that You hang in there with us and You keep trying over and over to help us get it. Thank You for loving us. And Father, we would pray for our friends and for our community that is just so, so separated from the reality of being loved by You. They're just desperately trying to fill it in. God, they're on their eighth or ninth relationship trying to fill it in. They're on some substance trying to fill it in. They're busy trying to push their way to the front of the line and led by their ego, and they're just trying to fill it in. Father, we pray for our friends. Would You help them to discover that they were meant for more than that? That they were destined for more than that? That You have something for them that is amazing? And that they are loved by You, and that defines who they are. Nothing else. Thank You, God, for loving us. In Your name we pray. Amen. Amen. Amen.
Come on up. Speaking of kids, kids first through fifth grade, come on up. We're going to dismiss you to Kids Factory E. Morgan, thanks for asking a question. That was fun. Next week, all these kids will be coming around to collect money for BGMC, the Boys and Girls Missionary Challenge, so that we can support missionaries like the ones we just talked to. So bring your change and dollars or checks next week. We found that when we send cute little kids out, we get a much bigger offering for missions. It's part of our strategy. We use these cute faces. And middle schoolers, you're going to be headed out with Pastor Seth to talk about the fruit of the Spirit. So we'll be praying for you guys too. Drake is leading that talk. So you guys get to hear from Drake. All right, let's pray for our kids and middle schoolers. Dear Lord, we thank You for our young people. Thank You that You have a plan and a purpose for each of their lives, and You are working that out in Your time. So we pray, Lord, that You would continue to guide the kids and the middle schoolers along the path that You have for their life, and help them to make the right choices to cooperate with Your plan and to love You more and obey You more and step by step follow You. Amen. All right, we'll see you guys later. Tonight is our first of two annual business meetings, so I encourage all of you to come. We've been talking about it for a while, and I know the excitement has just been building. I can see it in your eyes right now. But like Jeanette said last week, I am very grateful that we are part of a church that is open about our finances. And so if you want to come here, where your money goes when you give in the offering every week, come find out tonight. And next week will be the official business meeting where we approve the financial reports and elect elders and talk about our vision for our church for the next year. That's my only announcement today. Isn't that great? I love it when I just get one announcement. So, hey, we're starting our series on the book of Acts. So you can probably open up your Bible there, and let's welcome Pastor Dennis to preach God's word to us.
We got lots of stuff up here. Here, you want this?
Yeah.
You can have it.
Thank you.
It's free to you. Hey, speaking of annual business meeting tonight, we have some new members we'd like to introduce to you. These are some people that have gone through the process and have chosen to be members here. I remember when I first came and was a part of this church, Vic Trimmer was the pastor. Some of you remember Vic, and I've never been able to preach like him, but one of these days, maybe, if I keep practicing. He was built like a middle linebacker, and he preached like a middle linebacker. I mean, it was somebody said hut, and he went for it, you know? And somewhere toward the end, he took a breath and said amen, you know? But, I mean, he just went for it. But he used to always say that you don't have to be a member of this church to come and be a part of the ministry that happens here and to share in the different kinds of things that take place. But the reality is, if it weren't for the members, there wouldn't be a church for you to participate in. That some people have to make some commitments. And based on those people's commitments, we're able to do some things that we just wouldn't be able to do otherwise. So I just want to invite these people to come up. And these are, we've got them in alphabetical order here, as I noticed. There's some structure to this list right here. So Kurt and Mary Hitchin, not to be confused with Valerie Kitchen. So it sounds the same, not the same. And Pamela Lee and Nancy O'Leary and Matthew Potts. Has anybody ever called you Matthew? It's always Matt, isn't it? Matthew, it's very, very formal today. Charles and Brittany Pretty. Mark and Faith Reiling and Jeff and Teresa Waite. Everybody decided to stand on this side. All right. You guys can stand on this side if you want. You can just be different. Got your own space. So I just wanted you to have an opportunity to see and to meet and to greet these folks. I'm going to ask some of the staff and elders just to come, and we're going to pray for you guys this morning and pray a couple of things. One is that we want to say thanks for you. We want to say thanks for who you are. We want to say thanks for your commitment. We want to say thanks for being here. But we're also going to pray and ask that God would really give you a sense of purpose and direction and destiny in regards to being a part of the body here, of sharing in the ministry that God has for us. And so we just want to say thank you. We want to say thanks to God for you, and we want to pray that God would help you and give you real clarity and direction. So church, if you just join me, we're just going to pray for these. Father, I thank you for each and every one of these lives. Father, I'm just struck by the fact nobody up here looks like anybody else that's standing up here. They are unique in and of themselves. And I thank you that that goes beyond their appearance. I thank you that that goes to the very core of who they are, that you have uniquely created every one of them, that they stand here uniquely made in your image but different from everyone else. I thank you that they bring unique gifts. I thank you that they bring unique abilities. I thank you that they have unique stories and testimonies of how your grace found them. I pray, dear Father, that you would now help them to find places of significant ministry. And I know that many of them are already involved in things, but I pray, Father, that today would be kind of a step up in regards to that, that you would give them a true sense of this is my place in the kingdom and this is the work that I do. So I pray, Father, that you would bless them. We have been blessed by them coming and saying, hey, I want to do life with you guys. I thank you, Father, that we now get to share back with them and say, okay, then let's go do this together. So, Father, I pray that you would bless them in unique and special ways. In your name we pray. Amen. Amen. Bless you guys. Thanks again. We appreciate it. Thank you, thank you, thank you. Stephen said we are going to start in on the book of Acts. Hopefully you have been reading that and studying it or looking at it a little bit. We asked you to kind of get a jump on that and move ahead. So we're going to start with Acts chapter 1, verse 1. How'd that be? Let's just start there. We could start in Genesis and work our way up, but that'd just take too long. So we'll just start with Acts chapter 1, verse 1. One of the things that just continues to be important for me is for you to be able to truly own your Bible. That ability to actually take the Word of God, to be able to read that and to have some sort of understanding of what you read. And to recognize that in the process, there is all kinds of conversation. And it's interesting, conversation used to be a little bit more limited in the past. Now, you know, just via the internet, you can just about do anything or hear anything you want, post anything you want to post, and then argue about it with each other. And yeah, I mean, just it's all over the place. And when it comes to Scripture, there's a lot of discussion that is, not mature or necessarily always accurate. And you can get caught in a lot of that. And there's just some kind of subtleties that can happen as well, especially when you look at a book of, like Acts. So for those of you that have read the book of Acts, or at least gave it a shot, read part of it, as you start to go through it, one of the things you're going to notice is that it's a narrative. It's a story, right? Luke says, hey, Theophilus, the guy he's writing this for, he said, I just went around and asked guys a bunch of questions. I wanted to find out what was going on, so I wrote some things down so that you could understand the story. And if you notice, partway through the book of Acts, Luke went from talking about them to talking about us, we. Luke's in the story. He's not a main character. He doesn't take credit for anything. But there's a point where he gets involved. He's actually involved in the events that he's recording. Prior to that, he said, hey, there were things going on before I got involved. So he goes back and writes about what was happening. But it's a narrative. So one of the things that happens, you're going through the book of Acts and you read that something that happened, is that you have to go, should that happen again? Or you look at it and go, that was a one-timer. That was something that happened one time. It's probably not supposed to happen again. And one of the things that happens as people go through the book of Acts is that quite often they will say, well, that's the way the early church did it, so that's how we should do it. And they'll use that to go back and grab something. Now, it's amazing that when they go back and grab something that happens in the book of Acts and say, well, because it happened in the early church, that's the way we should do it, they don't always grab everything that happened. So how do you tell the difference between grabbing everything that happened and picking and choosing, and on what basis do you pick and choose? So one of the things that a lot of people struggle with is going to show up right here in the first chapter. And that is that Peter gets together and says, hey, Jesus picked 12 guys. He picked 12 guys so that they could give testimony to what he had taught and so that they could give eyewitness testimony to his resurrection. And one of the guys abandoned his post, and we're down a man. So let's go get another one. And then they roll dice to pick the guy. Very few people that reach back to the book of Acts and say, well, that's the way the early church did it, that's how we should do it, opt for the idea of using dice to decide the will of God. And yet it's just as much in there as all the other stuff. So when you reach back to the book of Acts and go, well, that's the way the early church did it, that's how we ought to do it, based on what do you eliminate certain things and include others? So don't get sucked in just because somebody said, well, it's in the book of Acts, that's the way we should do it. Well, I don't know, maybe it is, maybe it isn't. How do you decide? We're going to try to figure that out as we go along, and we're going to try to figure out this issue of inspiration. So we know that the Scripture itself tells us that Scripture is inspired by the Holy Spirit, moving through people to record some things. So on one level, on this human level, Luke is trying to tell his friend what happened. So Luke is going to go, well, this happened, and then that happened, and this happened. That wasn't very important. I'll leave that out. But this was pretty significant. I'll make sure I talk about that for a while. And Luke is making choices, just as a person, about what's important. And so obviously, the book of Acts shifts over and begins to follow one particular person because it becomes the we part of the story. And Luke is included in that. It's not that other people weren't doing other things. It's that Luke wasn't with those other people. So he writes about the we part of it. And he talks about that. So we want to kind of follow that. We want to be able to track with that. We want to be able to make some sort of sense out of it and follow the story and see why is it that he would have done that. But there's also this inspiration of the Holy Spirit, where the Holy Spirit is nudging Luke, saying, don't leave this part out. This is important. And so while we could just study it as history and try to figure out what Luke had in mind, what we want to do is to try to study it accurately and find out what the Holy Spirit had in mind when the Holy Spirit encouraged Luke to record certain things. And so what we're going to do as we move through the story is look for the challenge. What's the Holy Spirit trying to tell the church? Luke's writing to Theophilus. The Holy Spirit's writing to us. We want to find out why the Holy Spirit had Luke write what he wrote. Fair enough? So that's what we're going to do. So we're just going to read through the first chapter of the book of Acts. Get it up on the screen in our heads so that we can see what's going on. It's on page 758 there in the Bible in front of you. You brought your own? That's what the index is for. In my former book, Theophilus, which would be what? The Gospel according to St. Luke, as it says on the top of the page, right? So that's the first book that he wrote. In my former book, Theophilus, I wrote about all that Jesus began to do and teach until the day he was taken to heaven after giving instructions through the Holy Spirit to the apostles he had chosen. After his suffering, he presented himself to them and gave many convincing proofs that he was alive. He appeared to them over a period of 40 days and spoke about the kingdom of God. On one occasion, while he was eating with them, he gave them this command: do not leave Jerusalem, but wait for the gift my Father promised, which you have heard me speak about. For John baptized with water, but in a few days you will be baptized with the Holy Spirit. When they gathered around him and asked him, Lord, are you at this time going to restore the kingdom to Israel? So Jesus is teaching about the kingdom of God. They are talking about the kingdom of Israel. They had trouble putting those two thoughts together. So they come back to their thought. Remember James and John's mother comes to Jesus and says, hey, when you come into your kingdom, can one of my kids sit on the right and the other one sit on the left? And Jesus is going, not my call. The Father decides that. And then it ticked off the other 10 and they had one of their squabbles, you know. And so this kingdom thing, they're having trouble. So they said, Lord, are you at this time going to restore the kingdom to Israel? He said to them, it's not for you to know this time or the date, for the Father has set these by his own authority. But you will receive power. So here's what you're supposed to be focused on, guys. You will receive power when the Holy Spirit comes on you, and you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem, in Judea, in Samaria, and to the ends of the earth. After he had said this, he was taken up before their very eyes, and a cloud hid him from their sight. And they were looking intently up into the sky as he was going, when suddenly two men dressed in white stood beside them. Men of Galilee, they said, why do you stand here looking into the sky? This same Jesus who has been taken from you into heaven will come back in the same way that you have seen him go into heaven. Then the apostles returned to Jerusalem from the hill called the Mount of Olives, a Sabbath day's walk from the city. When they arrived, they went upstairs to the room where they were staying. Those present were Peter, John, James, Andrew, Philip, Thomas, Bartholomew, Matthew, James the son of Alphaeus, and Simon the Zealot, and Judas the son of James. They all joined together constantly in prayer, along with the women and Mary, the mother of Jesus, and with his brothers. In those days, Peter stood up among the believers, a group numbering about 120, and he said, brothers and sisters, the scripture has been fulfilled in which the Holy Spirit spoke long ago through David concerning Judas, who served as a guide for those who arrested Jesus. He was one of our number. He shared in our ministry. With the payment he received for his wickedness, Judas bought a field. There he fell headlong. His body burst open. All his intestines spilled out. Everyone in Jerusalem heard about this, so they called that field in their language Akeldama, which is field of blood. For, said Peter, it is written in the book of Psalms, may his place be deserted, let there be no one to dwell in it, and may another take his place of leadership. Therefore, it's necessary to choose one of the men who has been with us the whole time the Lord Jesus was living among us, beginning from John's baptism to the time when Jesus was taken up from us. For one of these must become a witness with us of his resurrection. So they nominated two men, Joseph, called Barsabbas, also known as Justice, and Matthias. Then they prayed, Lord, you know everyone's heart. Show us which of these two you have chosen to take over the apostolic ministry, which Judas left to go where he belongs. Then they cast lots. The lot fell to Matthias, and he was added to the 11 apostles. So here we are in transition. We're transitioning between the Gospel of Luke and the other book that Luke wrote, this Acts of the Apostles. The ascension is part of that transition. Jesus told his disciples he was leaving, right? John 14, 15, 16, Jesus talks about that. He says, look, I'm leaving. The Holy Spirit is going to come. That's going to be a good thing. He's explaining what's about to take place. So now Luke is recording for us this transition. In the process, again, he's recording for us the fact that the disciples are still confused about some things. He's talking to us about the fact that they go and they see Jesus leave, but the cool thing is the promise is he's coming back, which is the very thing that he said. He said, I go to prepare a place for you. So Jesus is in heaven. He's preparing a place for us. He's making intercession for us. He is the one who is, because of his entrance into heaven, is now saying, okay, the Holy Spirit comes and takes my place. Luke is trying to get us to understand we're in transition here. Something changed. Something different's taking place. So he says, go and wait. Go and wait for the person who is promised. So the ministry of Jesus is becoming the ministry of the Holy Spirit. It's the Holy Spirit revealing and exalting Jesus through people. And so often, I don't know for sure what your Bible says at the top of it, but quite often it'll say the Acts of the Apostles. It probably more accurately should be the Acts of the Holy Spirit expressed through the Apostles. That's probably a better way to understand it. One of the first things that happens is this whole discussion about who are apostles, who are they, how many of them should there be, do we keep having more of them, what is this role and place of the apostle, and so we get into that whole discussion. Luke seems to be pretty restrictive in how he uses the word apostle. Generally, he means the 12 that were called by Jesus, which came to mean the original 11 plus Matthias, who was chosen to take Judas Iscariot's place, that Peter says he abandoned his position. There was necessary for that position to be filled. He abandoned it. We have an open slot. 11's not enough. We need to fill it. That was Peter's whole reasoning. Paul uses this word apostle in a much broader reference, and he refers to a number of people who worked with him and declares the working of the kingdom of God out to the Gentiles was done through various apostles. So I just need to tell you that the attempts to settle the definition of the word and thus defining, does it only mean the original 12, or is it understood in a broader sense, is often a pretty technical argument. It gets down to some technical issues. It gets down to some language issues. I'll tell you that it also gets down to some opinion issues, because people have an opinion about how they want the question to be answered because of what they believe about something else. So let me just give you some of those other kinds of things. The Roman Catholic concept is of apostolic succession, that Jesus specifically looked at Peter, gave him a unique authority, that unique authority is constantly passed down from person to person through the position of the Bishop of Rome. So they believe in this idea of apostolic succession. So they want to keep the idea that apostle means maybe more than just the 12. There are people who are interested in, and this was in the early church, of deciding what writing should be included in the Bible and what shouldn't. And one of their tests was, can the writing be directly connected to one of the original 12? Well, then they extended that out to Paul. And so they said, it has to be connected to one of those. There are some people today that are very interested in being able to say, are there apostles in the church today? I'll just tell you this. I've never read anything that defended the position of apostle today that was written by somebody who did not, by the end of his book, claim to be an apostle today. So they're pretty interested in being able to say, hey, I'm one of them, uniquely called by God, have unique revelation and have authority that no one else has. And so it's just interesting to me. One guy waited till the very last chapter. So I got to give him credit. A lot of them just start right up front. Hey, there's apostles, I am one, listen to me, you know. But this guy at least wrote his whole book and then got around to the last chapter of saying, and by the way, I think I'm one of those guys. It gets tied up into the whole issue of the role of women. Because Paul uses the word apostle to describe a woman who worked with him in the ministry. So I'll just tell you that this whole discussion about whether or not there are present-day apostles, what the role of the apostle is, whether it was just those original 12 guys, minus one, add Matthias, do you include Paul, how do you include him, it gets to be a really technical thing, and I'll tell you that people way smarter than me disagree with me and each other. And quite often, part of the reason they disagree with each other is because of how they want to answer these other questions. Because those that want to severely limit the role of women in ministry really struggle with the fact that Paul called a woman an apostle. And people who want to have present-day authority really like the idea that it either got handed down or that they can claim to be one. So it gets tied up in all these other arguments. I'll tell you that at the end, it seems to be deliberately vague, and that's probably on purpose, which means we probably shouldn't worry so much about it. We probably ought to just kind of let it go. Because if Jesus wanted it to be clear, he'd have made it clear. The Holy Spirit knows how to be very, very specific. And when he's not, we probably shouldn't be trying to get specific on his behalf. But it's really fun for people who are bored and have nothing better to do than to argue about the role of apostles in the church today. It gives them something to talk about. I'm just saying, I think we probably ought to back away from it and recognize that the church has done some rather unique kinds of things in the sense that it gets down to a fairly small group of people that seem to have a unique authority in the structure and building of the church. The simple conclusion is that while the church did then, continued to do through the story of Acts, and needs to now recognize authority within the church, and people don't like that idea, I know. But we need to recognize authority, that the role of the apostles seems to be mostly, if not completely limited, to those who were witnesses of the resurrection of the Lord. And their unique position gave them authority in the establishment of the church and in the writing of Scripture. So that's the first part. But people love to argue about that stuff. This process of being a witness for Jesus, his teaching and his resurrection, is the work to which Jesus himself had called these people. It says, formerly they had experienced the Spirit through the presence of Jesus. After Pentecost, they would experience Jesus through the presence of the Spirit. There is this unique change that's happening. And it's this being connected with the Holy Spirit in a personal way, not just a generic sense, but in a very personal way, that is pretty much core to the message that the apostles have. It's core to their experience. It's the thing that they keep coming back to. When the Apostle Paul describes what it means to live as a Christian, he ties it back to what it means to live by and through the Spirit. I don't think there's any more telling place for that than when he writes to the Corinthians. And so he writes this letter to the Corinthians, and he's writing it in response to a letter they sent him, and they sent him a bunch of questions, and so he starts to answer those. And as you read through 1 Corinthians especially, you can just see him taking the questions and answering them one at a time. But he starts with something that's more important than that. He talks to them about it, what it means to be people of the Spirit, and he says, I could not write to you as people who are of the Spirit. I could not write to you as people who are mature. I had to write to you as if you were merely human. It's an interesting phrase, as if you were merely human. Remember when we went through the Gospel of John, we talked about the fact that we had many of our friends who were only mostly dead. Stole the line from the Princess Bride. But what did we mean by that, only mostly dead? They were physically alive. Someone had given birth to them. Their biological systems worked. They breathed in air. They processed oxygen into their blood. They ate food and they turned it into sugars and other things that their body could use to keep itself alive. They were functioning that way. But the spirit within them was dead. They were mostly dead. And it's when the Spirit of God comes to dwell in the building, the body that was designed to hold it, that's when that body comes alive. So it goes back to that story in Ezekiel where he talks about the temple of God and that the temple of God is just bricks and mortar if the Spirit of God isn't in that temple. And when the Spirit leaves the temple, the city was vulnerable. That was the message from Ezekiel. That you keep claiming that the city of Jerusalem is safe from all outside attacks because the temple of God is in the city. Ezekiel said, if the Spirit leaves the temple, it's bricks and mortar and you're vulnerable. It's when the Spirit is in the temple that you have protection and life. So when we look at someone who is physically alive, but there is no Spirit inside that temple that was created to house the Holy Spirit, they're mostly dead. So it's that concept, that idea. And so what the book of Acts begins to tell us is how did people learn to live with the person and power of the Holy Spirit? Because without that, Paul's going to write to us and say, I couldn't write to you as people who were fully alive. I could not write to you as people who were mature. I could not write to you as people who held the Spirit because you are behaving in a way that indicates that you are merely human. No Spirit. Pretty telling. Paul said, you get to choose. Are you merely human? Or are you the temple of the Holy Spirit? And if you are, by the way, you should get along. Because that was his thing. He said, how do I know that you're merely human? He says, because you can't get along. There's divisions among you. Some of you say, well, I follow Peter and I follow Paul. Really spiritual ones, oh, we follow Jesus. He's gone, oh, you're all merely human. No Spirit at all. You haven't been transformed. You haven't been changed. There's no power there. And so this book is about how did some people help us figure this out? So as it starts, they're supposed to become witnesses of some things. They're supposed to become witnesses of the kingdom of God, of the works and words of Jesus, and specifically of his resurrection. One of the songs that we sang this morning, we sang, I believe that you rose again. And I believe that you are Lord, or in this context, use the word Messiah. I believe that you are that. That's the core of what we believe, and that's what we give witness to. And so they ask the question, you know, is the kingdom of God coming back to Israel? And he's going, that's not the point. You guys are off point. Get back over here. Your job is to be a witness of these things and not worry about how that part of it works out. The Father will take care of all of that later. So here it is, and there's kind of a long quote there, and it's in your notes. It says, their assignment is to be witnesses of Jesus' words and deeds. That's what they've been called to do. The Holy Spirit that he has promised them was going to come and give them the power to actually be those witnesses. Because you can't be the witness without that. The power will be seen in the record is the power to do certain things. One of it was the power to withstand persecution. That's one of the reasons the Holy Spirit was given, so that you could withstand persecution. There's some people that really want to believe that the Holy Spirit has been given so that we can be exempt from persecution. The book of Acts will teach us that the Holy Spirit was given us so that we could withstand persecution, not be exempt from it. It's the power to speak life-changing words. That when you get into certain situations, Jesus said, it's going to get tough, you're going to get nervous, I need you to back up, take a deep breath, believe that the Holy Spirit within you is going to give you the words to know what to speak. He's going to give you life-changing words to speak. And it's going to be the power to accomplish miraculous things. The power to accomplish miraculous things. I will tell you that nowhere in the book of Acts will we read a situation or a circumstance where the church understood living with God without the miraculous. They didn't understand that. It was just part and parcel of what it meant to live out their experience. So Jesus promises them that they will have power and that they will be witnesses. And so Jesus gives them specific directions. Go and wait in Jerusalem for the promised Holy Spirit and then go be witnesses. And then he's taken up into heaven. And so what do? They stand there and stare up at the sky. Jesus said, go into Jerusalem. They're going, I don't know. I think I still see him. I don't know. He might be up there somewhere. Yeah? It's like when you lose your helium balloon, you want to see how far you can still see it before it disappears, you know? There they stand there. They're supposed to be going back into Jerusalem. One guy noted this. He said, moments of high spiritual experience are never ends in themselves. Ooh. Moments of high spiritual experience are never ends in themselves. It was time for them to come down from the mountain and witness to what they had seen. We have these amazing spiritual experiences, and what's the first thing we want to do? Have another one just like it. Let's do that over again. Woo-hoo! The roller coaster was fun. Let's ride it again. Jesus said, no. I have work for you to do. I don't want to do the work. I want to ride a roller coaster one more time. Come on, I just feel so good. Woo! Love that free fall. He says, no. You got work to do. You got work to do. And so Jesus said, I want you to go back. I want you to be in Jerusalem. I want you to be waiting for that which was promised. And then I want you to be witnesses. And I want you to go to Jerusalem, Judea, Samaria, and the uttermost parts of the earth. And as some people have pretty clearly noted, that's kind of an outline for the book of Acts. Because the book of Acts starts in Jerusalem, and then it goes to Judea and Samaria, and then it goes to the uttermost parts of the earth. And that's just kind of the story. So there's kind of an outline for you right there of how this story is going to unfold. And so they go back to Jerusalem. And at this point, there's a pretty large gathering of people, about 120 people. During the 40 days prior to that, people have been moving in and out. Remember the first time that Jesus catches up with his disciples, he catches up with them after the resurrection in Galilee. Half of them gone fishing again. They've gone back to their old occupations. So during that 40 days between the time Jesus is resurrected and the time that he's taken, there's a group of people that are moving in and out of Jerusalem. They're doing various things. Different stuff's happening. Sometimes we get it in our mind, okay, Jesus died. He's resurrected. They all go get in the upper room. And then, there's 40 days in there. So we got like a month and a half, and people are just walking around. They're doing business. They're taking care of whatever they need to take care of. They're doing whatever they need to do. Some of them are struggling with issues. That was Peter's whole deal. He was struggling with how he was supposed to fit into this whole thing. So we get this 40 days that's moving around where Jesus comes and says, hey, now it's time for you to go back. I want you to wait in Jerusalem. Get together, go wait in Jerusalem. And they're going to be there week to 10 days. I mean, we don't have an exact chronology here, but they're going to be there a week to 10 days. And they're going to be gathered together in the upper room. So they go back, they gather together, and they are to wait. Here's what I want you to see. Their waiting is not passive. They're not just sitting there waiting for something to happen. They are praying. They are praying. I want to read you this quote. It says, "The time before Pentecost was a time for waiting, a time spent in prayer, undoubtedly for the promised Spirit and for the power to witness." Listen to this statement. There is no effective witness without the Spirit, and the way to spiritual empowerment is to wait in prayer. Thanks for asking. I'll read it again. There's no effective witness without the Spirit, and the way to spiritual empowerment is to wait in prayer. So there's a lot of interesting things in Acts chapter 1 that you can discuss. You can get into the whole discussion about the apostles and who are they and who should they be and do we have them now and what is... You can get into all of that and you just go in circles. Talk about stuff that sounds really important, probably really isn't. You can fuss with that. Or you can just read the narrative and go, oh, and that happened and that happened and that happened. But I think there's a challenge for us. And when I say us, I don't mean necessarily every Christian that's alive on the planet today. But I think there is a challenge for us. I'm challenged by that comment. I'm challenged by that observation that there is no effective witness without the Spirit, and the way to spiritual empowerment is to wait in prayer. I'm challenged by that. The reason is because I'm a part of a group of people who do not wait, even for good things. We don't want to get out of our car to do our business. We don't want to get out of our car to buy our food. We don't want to get out of our car to eat our food. We don't want to get out of our car to stop and make phone calls. We want to keep moving. We are a group of people who do not wait. We don't even wait for good things. We want it now. Why in the world would you save up your money so you could pay cash for what you're after when you can put it on a card and get it now? Even if you got to pay 18% interest, you have it in your hand. And how often is it broke before you paid it off? We don't wait. That's not the American thing. We don't wait. We don't save up our money. We don't take time for things. We want everything to happen as fast as it possibly can. And I think because of that, ours is often a spirituality of the moment. It's developed in a moment, and we are committed to it for a moment. And we lose what it means to truly be spiritual. I think it weakens our spirituality. I believe that it cheapens in us our understanding of the miraculous. I think that's one of the reasons why we try so hard to reduce the miraculous to formulas. Because if I can get a formula, all I have to do is to fill in the blank, and the miraculous will happen on demand when I want it to take place. And I don't have to wait. And I can control what's happening. Jesus told the disciples, you go back in the upper room and you wait. And he didn't even tell them what to do. They chose to pray. He said, I just want you to wait. And I'll just tell you, if you'd ask a group of Americans to go and do that, on the day of Pentecost, there'd have been two people instead of 120. Because we'd all found something else to do. You're going, man, I am 6 days into this. What in the world are we waiting for? Hey, nothing's happening. We tried standing on our head. We tried spinning around. We tried being desperate. We tried proclaiming faith. We tried calling down fire from heaven. We tried doing it all. Been here almost the whole week. Nothing happening. I got things to do. I'm out of here. Can you imagine that? If you'd have tried to have the day of Pentecost in America, the church would have never been born. Holy Spirit would have come to an empty room. I'm here to help you, but everybody left. Got nobody to work on. We said we were going to read the book of Acts and let it challenge us. And I think here's our first challenge. Are we willing to wait in prayer for the promises of God? Or are we filling in those promises with our easy, quick preferences instead of waiting for that which is genuinely spiritual? It's just our way, isn't it? We are the ongoing witnesses. We are Christ's ambassadors, as if he were making his appeal to the world through us. Look what Jesus said in Luke's first book, in Luke 18. It says, Jesus told his disciples a parable to show them that they should always pray and not give up. It's always nice when they explain the parable to you so that you know what it means, because it makes you look so much smarter. Oh, I know what that parable means. Well, yeah, because they told you what it meant. He said, in a certain town, there was a judge who neither feared God nor cared what people thought. And there was a widow in that town who kept coming to him with this plea, grant me justice against my adversary. For some time, he refused. But finally, he said to himself, even though I don't fear God nor care what people think, yet because this widow keeps bothering me, I will see that she gets justice so that she won't eventually come and attack me. Judges, he's got a stalker. He's going, this woman's borderline right here, you know? The Lord said, listen to what the unjust judge says. Will not God bring about justice for his chosen ones who cry out to him day and night? Will he keep putting them off? I tell you, he will see that they get justice and quickly. That our Heavenly Father will react not like the unjust judge, but will react better. However, when the Son of Man comes, when he comes back the way he went up, will he find faith on the earth? What's the context of that faith? That we ought always to pray and never give up. That we ought to be willing to wait for what God has promised. And not substitute the promises of God and true spirituality for some quick, easy formula of, I think if we do it this way, we can get God to do what we want, and we can get him to do it now, not next week. Are we willing to wait in prayer? Told you before that there's a friend of mine that studied a bunch of this stuff, and he wrote a bunch of books, and what he was trying to do was to figure out the blend between mental health and faith. People who actually have functionality in life, healthy function, and faith. What's the connection? And so he began to look at all the spiritual disciplines, all the things that you can do. His determination after all of this research was that the one thing you can do that is more impactful in your life than any other spiritual discipline is 15 minutes of silence and prayer in the morning and 15 minutes of silence and prayer in the evening. He said the people who do that are healthier, more well-adjusted, emotionally stable, and have better relationships than the people who do any other thing. Now, that's pretty significant, because as Christians, we do a lot of stuff. I mean, we're constantly trying to get you to read your Bible, right? I mean, we had the whole thing with Braden's deal, and then he came back with another one for Lent, and we thought, you know, let's try that. And somebody said, well, but we already have that Bible reading plan that's right there, that thing right there in front of you. See that little blue form that's right there? And how you can read your Bible in a year, and then on the other side, you can flip it over and how to read the New Testament in a year. And we keep saying, we need you to read your Bible, read your Bible. It's like, that's a really important thing to do. But isn't it interesting that even more important than that, when it comes to how spirituality affects your actual life, is whether or not you will simply wait before God. It was Mother Teresa's habit to do that, and a reporter interviewed her and said, what do you hear when you go do that? And she said, I don't always hear anything. And I said, well, if you don't always hear things, why do you go? She said, because it's important for me to be available whether he speaks or not. It's important for me to be available whether he speaks or not. The first 9 days that 120 people were gathered in that room, God didn't say anything, and they still prayed. The first 9 days they were there, God didn't do anything, and those 120 people were still there. But oh my goodness, flip the page and look what happens when God shows up after 10 days. Pretty cool stuff. If you quit on day 9, you don't get what happens on day 10. So it's just pretty straight out. I'd love to tell you that I put this together and that challenge is for you. I will simply have to tell you that the challenge is for me. So when it comes to these next step cards, and we're going to collect our next step cards, we're going to collect our offering in just a moment. So I can't mark the first one because I've already committed my life to Christ and been baptized in water, but if you haven't done that, you need to check that one right there. I can certainly check this next one. I will let God define what is spiritual, because it's so easy to try to fill in for him and say, well, this is spiritual, so let's do that. You know, because it's always easy to define spirituality in terms of what you like to do, because then you do it quite naturally and it makes you look spiritual. It's when God defines spirituality and it's something you don't want to do that it's tough. Okay, I'll let God define what is spiritual. And I will be willing to wait in prayer for what is promised and needed. I don't do very good at that. I'm just like too ADD to wait very long. I really wonder if I was in Acts chapter 1, there's a really good chance I'd have been the guy that had gone out to get something to eat when the Holy Spirit came. I just know me. I just know me. You know? So after 9 days of being up there eating whatever we had, it's time to get something fresh to eat for dinner. You know? I get fidgety. I start moving around too much. And I'm the classic guy that starts to pray, and pretty soon I realize I'm not talking to God anymore. You ever do that? I mean, you ever think about how horribly rude that is? I mean, would you do that to someone else? I mean, if they were sitting there in front of you and you started talking to them, would you just suddenly just wander off mid-sentence and start talking to somebody else? How many times you do that in prayer? Oh, God, we need and I need to get eggs and milk. And, oh, my goodness gracious, how rude is that? You're literally going to go to the throne of the universe and find Almighty Creator God, get His attention, and then wander off rudely mid-sentence. I have to put it in those kind of terms. And I can't tell you how many times I have to apologize in the middle of my prayer and say, God, that was really rude. I'm sorry. How can I let my mind wander when I have a private audience with the Creator of the universe? Really? I am willing to wait in prayer. Even if He doesn't say anything or do anything, because I need to be available. I think it's a huge challenge. I think it's a huge challenge because we don't do it very well. Don't fill in. If God doesn't answer, don't answer for Him. Way too many stories how that goes wrong. Don't fill in for Him. And you know what? If He hasn't answered, you don't need the answer yet. I don't care how nervous you get. You don't need the answer yet. So just wait. 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 We don't do it very well. The ushers are going to come. They're going to collect our next step cards, and we're going to bring it up here and pray. We should pray really slow and long, make you wait. Not going to do that. While we're giving in the offering, we've got a quick video I think we're going to show that talks about one of the ministries of the church that's starting up here.
I really thought that marriage would be like a fairy tale.
I couldn't go into my bedroom.
There are too many memories.
I felt abused, manipulated, and betrayed.
I made mistakes in my marriage.
I was under so much stress.
I didn't know you could hurt that much and not die.
Going through separation or divorce is painful and traumatic. Unfortunately, few people understand what you're going through, and even fewer know how to help. That's why there's Divorce Care. Divorce Care is a comforting 13-week group led by caring people who understand what you're going through. Each week, you'll watch and discuss a video that offers hope and practical tips that you can use to stabilize and move forward. Plus, you'll receive a helpful workbook that gives you insights on how to survive a divorce. It also contains the inspirational stories of others who've survived situations similar to yours.
My anger drove my wife away. I found peace at Divorce Care.
I thought a new relationship would heal my pain. I found comfort at Divorce Care.
Divorce Care kept me from making decisions that I'd later regret.
I found the answers I was looking for at Divorce Care.
When you walk into Divorce Care, you're home.
So join a group today and find
help,
hope,
and healing
at Divorce Care.
Yeah.
Probably not very many things that are as personally difficult as that, to be in that place in life. So we're just trying to bring the healing of Jesus there. And if you've got some friends maybe that are walking through that, invite them to come with you. Don't send them. Invite them to come with you. And you're going, man, I'm not divorced. Don't worry about it. Take your friend. Take your friend. It's important. They need that help. So I encourage you to do that. The ushers are going to bring these cards that we signed up here, and we're going to pray. So I just want to warn you in advance, what I'm going to pray is that God would give us the strength and the courage and the motivation to wait in prayer. So you might want to leave now if you don't want me to pray for that. As I'll tell you, one of the things that will happen is that there will be circumstances that come about in your life that will drive you to prayer. Because that's what we're going to pray for, that God would teach us to pray, teach us to always pray and to not give up, to teach us to go and wait and not to fill in for him when he doesn't answer on day one, but to wait for what he has promised and to let that waiting change us so that we become different kinds of people. So, Father, I thank you for the fact that you are a good, good Father. We sang that. And that we are loved by you, and that you are perfect in all of your ways. So, Father, we confess that through worship and singing and prayer earlier, we come back to that now and say that if that's the case, then we need to hear from you. We need you to do what only you can do, and you don't need us to fill in for you. And so forgive us for all of the times when we rushed out ahead of you and said, this is a really cool idea, God. And thank you for the fact that when we got out there, you didn't abandon us. And when it got weird, you didn't yell at us. But forgive us for when all the things that have happened when we've run out there ahead of you. And forgive us for all of the times when we sat there in fear because we were unwilling to believe what you had said. So help us to find that place in the middle that says, I waited and listened, and here is what God has said. And so now I move ahead with confidence and with courage, but not with arrogance. With humility, but not with fear. Help us, God, in the busyness of our day, in the culture on this planet that originated the phrase wasting time. Could we back away from being driven by that and be people who know that waiting in your presence is the very opposite of wasting time? It is the only truly productive moment of our day. Help us to see that, to know that, and to do what is necessary to spend that time with you. Your name we pray. Amen. Amen. God bless you. Spend some time in prayer.
And your hand, it comforts me. From the ends of the earth to the depth of my heart, let your mercy strength be seen. You call me to your goodness as angels understand. For your glory, may you draw.